So we'll start with the fourth module, that is chapter 12, Media Access Control, also called as the MAC. As per the syllabus, you'll be able to see that it's written as Media Access Control. It's the same thing as far as Media Access Control is concerned. Okay, shall we? So we'll start with the chapter 12, that is the Media Access Control. The objectives of this chapter, whatever the thing that we are going to study today, is random access, control access, and generalization. So as far as our first module is concerned, we have already studied the OSI model and all, where we have seen something called as the data link layer. The data link layer is actually been divided into two parts, that is the data link control and the multiple access resolutions. Now the upper layer that is responsible for flow and error control is called as the logical link layer, that is this part, and the lower layer that is mostly responsible for multiple access resolution is called as the medium access control, that is the MAC layer. Now when nodes or stations are connected and used a common link called as a multipoint or a broadcast link, we need a multiple access protocol to coordinate access to the link. Okay, so whenever we are having a multipoint or a broadcast, multiple access resolution, that is this part, plays a very important role in the data link layer. The problem of controlling the access of the medium is similar to the rules of speaking in an assembly. So you must always see on television and all regarding this assembly part and all, where all the MLAs, whoever are sitting over there, tend to speak at the same time. But the proper message is actually not been received by the speaker. So in such cases, as far as whenever you are having a multipoint or a broadcast link, or whenever you are having a many stations connected to one single link, we are supposed to see to that when the station sends the data, there is no collisions. That is, the message should not collide with each other. So that is the thing we are going to study today as far as this chapter is concerned. The next part is taxonomy of multiple access protocol. Now, as far as the multiple access protocol is concerned, it's actually divided into three parts, that is random access protocol, control access protocols, and the generalization protocols. In random access protocols, again, we have Aloha, CSMA-CD, CSMA-CA. In control access protocols, we have three protocols, that is reservations, polling, and token ring. In generalization protocols, we have FDMA, TDMA, and CDMA. All these protocols, whatever is there in random access protocol, control access protocol, as well as generalization protocols, we are going to study in detail as far as this chapter. So we'll go with the first part, that is the random access. Random access is also called as the contentions. Now, random access, the term itself tells you all that the stations or the people who are connected or the senders that are connected to a link can send at a random time. There is no specific time as such when they are going to send the data. Because of that, it is called as the random access. As far as contention is concerned, what does a contention means is nothing but there is no rule or specific rule that they follow. That is the standard follow or the stations follows. In the random access, you are supposed to keep in mind there is nothing called as a superior and an inferior. All the stations are treated equally. That is, in random access or contentions, no station is superior to another station and none is assigned control over another. At each instance, the station that has a data to send uses the procedure defined by a protocol to make a decision on whether or not to send. These stations depend upon the state of the medium, idle or busy. So whenever you want to send a data, you are supposed to check whether that particular medium, in case suppose you are using a wired one, you are supposed to check whether the station is going to check or the sender has to check whether the medium is free or not. Idle means nothing but free. Okay, in case suppose the channel or the medium is free or idle, then the sender can send the data. Else the sender has to wait for some time until and unless the other stations are done with sending of the data. The first protocols in random access that we are going to study is Aloha. Aloha is the earliest random access method, was developed at the University of Hawaii in the early 1970s. It was designed for a radio wireless LAN, but it can be used on any shared mediums. It is obvious that there are potential collisions in this arrangement. Why there will be collisions is only because the medium is shared. It's the same thing is written over here in the remaining part. The medium is shared between the stations. When the station sends data, another stations may attempt to do so at the same time. When another stations sends the data or the message at the same time, obvious, then the data from the two stations are going to collide with each other and become scrambled. That is, the proper message that the sender has sent will not be able to get received by the receiver or at the destinations in the proper way. Now, if you go to see, as far as this diagram is concerned, there are altogether four stations which are there. Station 1, 2, 3 and 4. At the first instant when the station 3 has sent the data, none other stations have sent the data. So what has happened over here? The message that the station 3 has sent has been received at the receiver end at the proper way. But if you go to see at the next part, that is in the next portion, that is over here, station 4, when it senses the stations, okay, or the channel, it comes to see to that the channel is free, that is idle. So it sends the data. But station 2 was not aware over here that the station 4 has sent the data. So even station 2 tends to sense the data, which leads to the collisions. You'll be able to see over here that the collisions has taken place. The same thing has happened over here. Over here, if you go to see, station 1 has sent the data first, followed by station 4. But in that cases, neither of station 1, 2 or 3 or 4 were aware that the other station has sent the data, which has led to collision. Sorry. If you go to see over here, station 1 also has sent the data, but the other stations have not sent the data, due to which there is no collision has taken place. So this is the working how a pure aloha works. Aloha is also called as a pure aloha in the earlier times. So we'll go with the procedure. Before going to the procedures, we'll see what are the terms are. That is, K is nothing but the numbers of attempts. What are the number of attempts means? How many times I can send of that particular message? Okay, in case suppose it has not been reached at the destination end in the proper time. TP is the maximum propagation time. What is the maximum propagation time? Propagation time is nothing but the time it takes to reach at the destination. TP and TF is the same thing, that is the average transmission time. TB is nothing but the back off time. Back off time is nothing but R, that is the random number. You will be able to see over here. Random number is nothing but it will be the number between 0 to 2K minus 1. K is nothing but the numbers of attempts. So back off time is nothing but R into TP, that is the maximum propagation time, or R into TFR, that is the average transmission time. What is the back off time? Is nothing but it refrains from taking an action. That is, I'll explain you all the same thing as far as this algorithm is concerned. For example, the station has a frame to send. So at the first instant of time, the attempt K will be equals to 0. So you are going to send the frame. Now in that cases, you are going to sense the channel. So sensing of the channel will be what? Wait. In case suppose you are after sending of the data, you are going to check. Okay. So wait will be what? T2 into TP. That is the propagation time. That is the time required to send that particular message. In that cases, as far as aloha is concerned, students, you have one more thing that you are supposed to keep in mind. That is something called as acknowledgement. ACK is nothing but the acknowledgement. Can you see over here ACK? That is nothing but an acknowledgement. For example, suppose someone wishes on your birthday. Okay. So the thing that wishes will be what? Happy birthday. In return, what you'll say is nothing but thank you. What does thank you indicates over here is nothing but you have received a message. Okay. And in that you are returning the message saying that, that is you are replying to that sender saying that you have received and you are saying thank you. The same thing is applicable over here as far as aloha is concerned, as far as you and you are sending the data. Acknowledge directly indicates that a sender to the sender that the message has actually been received at the destination and in a proper way. Okay, one that is that it indicates when the receiver, okay, receives the acknowledgement, it indicates that the message has been received properly, okay, to the destination. In case suppose false, suppose the acknowledgement is not received. So what you are going to do? K will be equals to K K+1, that is the numbers of atoms you are going to send the same message, you are increasing it. Okay, now in that cases you are going to check whether K is greater than K max. K max will be what's the maximum number of times you can send the data. In that case, if it is lesser, you are going to choose the R. R is nothing but the random number. Random number is nothing but it has to be followed between 0 to 2k minus 1. So wait TB. What is TB? Is nothing but you are supposed to, that is the back of time. You are supposed to wait for some time and then send the data. In case suppose at the receiver end, suppose you receive the acknowledgement, that means you are not supposed to send the message again. In case suppose not, then increase the number of K. Okay, you are supposed to send a message until and unless K reaches the K max. Fine. So the example that is taken over here, a stations on a wireless Aloha network are a maximum of 600 km apart. If we assume that the signals propagate at 3×10⁸ minutes, that is meter per second, we find TP is equals to, that is the propagation time, 600 kilometer, since it is written in kilometer, and over here the signals propagate is written given to us in the form of a meters, so we are supposed to convert this kilometers into meters. Okay, so because of that 10⁻³ divided by 3×10⁸, that is this part. Okay, so what the answer we are getting is nothing but 2 meters per second. For K equals to 2, the range of R is, now in case suppose our value of K is 2, the range of R will be what is nothing but 0, 1, 2, 3. Are you getting this? Okay, which means that TB can be 0, 2, 4 and 6. Now, how are we getting this 0, 2, 4 and 6? In the earlier things, TB is nothing but R into TP. So, because of that, what is our TP value is 2. What is our K value is? Okay, that is our R value is 0, 1, 2 and 3. So 2×0 will give us 0, 2×1 will give us 2, 2×2 will give us 4, and 2×3 will give us 6. Okay, so based upon the outcome of the random number. Next, what we are going to see next is the vulnerable time of a pure Aloha protocol. So what exactly is happening over here? As far as this diagram is concerned, there are three stations, that is station A, B and C. Okay, for example, station C has sent the data at that time. Okay, and even afterwards, station B sends. What exactly happens over here? The end, that is B ends, collides with the C beginning. Can you still see the collisions over here? Similarly, in case suppose A also sends some data after some time. Okay, so what is happening over here? A ends, collides with the B beginning. Can you see the collisions over here that is taken place? So vulnerable time is nothing but 2× your TFR. Clear? Okay, so we'll take another example. A pure Aloha network transmits 200 bits frames on a shared channel of 200 kbps. What is the requirement to make the frame collision free? So in that cases, we are going to find out the first average frame transmission time, that is TFR, which is nothing but 200 bits divided by 200 kbps, which is, we are getting the answer as 1 ms. The vulnerable time is what? Is nothing but 2×TFR. That is here, we have already know the formula. So 2×1 ms, we are getting 2 ms. This means that no stations could send later than 1 ms or before the station starts transmission, or and no station should start sending during the period of 1 ms. That is this station, that this station is sending. What does this mean is nothing but the moment, suppose the station, there are three stations are there, assume once the station A or station 1 sends the data, the moment it is done, the next instant the other station, whoever wants to send the data, has to send the data. Now we'll go with the throughput. Throughput is nothing but, in that cases, let us call G is the average numbers of frames generated by the system during 1 frame transmission time. Then it is proved that the average numbers of successful transmissions for pure Aloha is The formula over here is S equals to G into E raised to 2G. Now, for example, if I calculate G as half, we will be getting the value of S is nothing but 0.128. How I'm going to get is nothing but students, substitute wherever G is there as half. So, half into E raised to minus 2 into half, I'll be getting the answer as 0.184. In other words, if one half of the frame is generated during the one frame transmission time, in other words, one frame during the two transmission times, then 18.4% of the frames reaches air destination successfully. This is an expected result because the vulnerable time is 2 times the frame transmission time. Therefore, if a station generates only one frame in this vulnerable time and no other station generates a frame during this time, the frame is going to reach at the destination successfully. So, in that case, you are supposed to keep this throughput in mind in such a way that such that the other station should not send the data at that instance so that to avoid the collisions. The same thing is explained in the form of a problem, students. What is the problem given to us is nothing but a pure Aloha network transmits 200 bits frames on a shared channel of 200 kbps. What is the throughput if the system or all stations together produces? Now, these are the things that is given. A, 1000 frames per second. B, 500 and then 250. So, in that cases, we'll go with the first one. That is 1000 frames per second. The solution will be the frame transmission time is 200 bits on the shared channel of 200 kbps. So, we'll be getting the answer as 1 minutes per second. That is 1 meters per second. MS. If the system creates 1000 frames per second or 1 frame per millisecond. Okay. So, the value of G will be 1. In these cases, what is the throughput value formula is S equals to G into E raised to minus 2G. That is nothing but if I substitute the value of G as 1, I'll be getting the answer as 0.135, which is nothing but 13.5%, which means that the throughput is 1000 into 0.135, I'll be getting 135 frames. Only 135 out of 1000 will probably survive. So, in that cases, to avoid the collisions, I'm supposed to see to that the data has been transmitted properly. Similarly, if I take for 500 frames per second, in that cases, my value of G will be half. So, if I substitute the value of G, I'll be getting as half, I'll be getting the S value, that is throughput value as 0.184, which is nothing but 18.4%. This means that the throughput is 500 into 0.184, I'll be getting 92. So, what does it mean? Which means that only 92 frames out of 500 will be probably survive. Note that this is the maximum throughput case percentage wise. In case suppose if I am having 250 frames per second, the value of G will be 1/4, which is nothing but if I substitute the value of G as 1/4, if I substitute it over here, I will be getting the value of S as 0.152, which is nothing but 15.2, which means that the throughput is 250 into 0.152, which is equals to 38. Only 38 frames are going to survive out of 250. Now, as far as to avoid whatever has happened earlier, in the pure Aloha, we have something called as the slotted Aloha. In slotted Aloha, what exactly is done is, we divide the time into slots, that is TFR, S, and forces the station to stand at the only at the beginning of that particular time slot. So, what happens over here, at time slot 1, okay, station 1 has sent the data, which has been received properly. Why? Because the other station has not sent me data. At time slot 2, what has happened? Collision has taken place because at the same slot, station 2 also has sent the data. At the same slot, station 3 also has sent the data. Because of which, it has led to the collisions. As far as the station 3 is concerned, station 1 as well as station 4 has sent the data at the same slot, which is again led to the collision. The next slot, as far as station 4, that is your slot 4, 5 and 6, if you go to see, station 2 only send the data which has led to successful receiving of the message at the receiver end. Similarly, at slot 5, station 4 has sent the data, which means that it has received it properly. Similarly, at slot 6, station 3 has sent the data, which has successfully received at the destination because there was no other stations to send the data. Now, as far as the slotted Aloha vulnerable time is nothing but TFR, only TFR. Okay. So, in that case, the throughput can be proved that the average numbers of successful transmissions for slotted Aloha is S is equal to G into E raised to minus G. What has happened as far as this pure Aloha? We have written E raised to minus 2G. Over here, as far as this slotted Aloha is concerned, it is E raised to minus G. So, in that case, when the value of G is 1, you will be getting the value of S max as 0.368. In other words, what it means, if a frame is generated during one frame transmission time, then 36.8% of these frames reach to the destination successfully. Fine. The same thing, that is the vulnerable time for slotted Aloha protocol. If you go to see what has happened over here is, at the same slot, station B and station C has sent the data, which has led to the collision. But over here, if you go to see, station A has sent the data at that particular slot, but no other station has sent the data. Okay, so because of that, there was no collisions over here. And the message that was sent by the station A has been received at the destination end in the proper way. The same problems, whatever we have taken for pure Aloha, we have taken it over here for slotted Aloha, where there are 1000 frames, 500 frames and 250 frames per second. So, we'll go with the first one. Okay, that is the solution to this problem. This station is similar to the previous exercise, except that the network is a slotted Aloha instead of pure Aloha. The frame transmission will be what? 200, that is 200 bits frames, okay, shared by the channels, that is 200 kbps bandwidth. Okay, so 200 divided by 200, I'll be getting the answer as 1 ms. In the first one, when it is 1000 frames, in this case, G value will be 1. So, S will be what? G into T raised to minus G. So, what is the value I'm getting? Is nothing but 0.368, that is 36.8%, which means that the throughput is 1000 into 0.368, which is equals to 368, that is 368 frames. Only 368 frames out of 1000 frames will be probably survive. The similar things for 500. In that case, my G value will be half. So, S is equals to G into E raised to minus G. I'll be getting the value as 0.303. So, that is 30.3%, which means that the throughput will be 500 into 0.0303, which is nothing but 1512. Only 151 frames out of 500 will probably survive. Okay, so the answer over here will be 151.2. Our students, just keep that into mind. Now, G is 1/4. Which means that S will be equal to G into E raised to minus G, that is 0.195, which is nothing but 19.5%. This means that the throughput is 250 into 0.195, which is equals to 49. Just make the changes over here, students. It is 0.3, not 0.0, as well as over here, it is 0.368 and not 0.0. Okay. So, value over here we have got. So, it is 0.3. By mistake, I have written over here. So, kindly do the changes. Fine. The next protocols as far as our random access protocol is concerned. The next method that we are going to study is carrier sense multiple access, also called as the CSMA. So, why we require the some disadvantage which are there. Okay, that is collisions takes place. Lot of collision takes place as far as your Aloha is concerned. To minimize it, we are using the carrier sense multiple access. To minimize the chances of collisions and therefore to increase the performance, the CSMA method was developed. The chance of collisions can be reduced if the station senses the medium before trying to use it. So, CSMA, that is the carrier sense multiple access, requires that each station first listen to the medium or check the state of the medium before sending it. In other words, CSMA is based upon the principle sense before transmit or listens before talk. So over here, what exactly we are doing is we are going to stage the medium first. In case suppose there are 3 stations or 4 stations, they are supposed to check the medium whether it's idle or not. In case suppose it is not idle, then the station has to wait for their time. In case suppose the medium is idle, then in that case the stations can send the data. Okay, so as far as this diagram is concerned, there are altogether 4 stations, students A, B, C and D. So what exactly happened over here is A has sent the data. Okay, that is area where B is. Okay, so in that cases, station here A is there, B, C and D is there. Now in that cases, what happens? For example, station B wants to send the data. Okay, so it senses the medium. Now no one is sending the data. So what has happened? B assumes that there is no one. Okay, no message is sent by either of the station, so he sends the data. Before the data from B reaches to this C station, what does the C does? C senses and it assumes that the medium is idle. No one is sending the data. But actually in reality, B has already sent the data, but it's yet to reach at the station C. So what has happened? Even station C, what it does? It checks for the medium. It senses that the medium is idle. So in that cases, even station C sends the data. So which has led to the collision. So assume that, for example, if station B wants to send the data to station D and station C wants to send the data to station A. Okay, so in that cases, what happens? Station A senses the medium. Sorry, station B senses the medium and checks that the medium is idle. So it sends the data. But before it reaches to the station C checks the medium and finds that the medium is idle. So even in turn, C sends the data. So because of that, there will be a collision that takes place between the data that is sent by the station B as well as by the station C. The same thing, vulnerable time of CSMA. Now if you go to C, here B senses the data. Okay, before the data reaches to C, C senses the data. Okay, the medium, and finds that the medium is idle and tends to sense the data. So because of that, there will be the collision. That is, the vulnerable time is nothing but the propagation time. Now, as far as the next subtopic is concerned, that is the persistent methods, we have studied the random access methods or the protocols. Why we require persistent method is, why a persistent method is used is only because what should be the station do if the channel is busy. In that may be a cases when the station senses and finds that the channel is busy at that instant of time. So what does the station are supposed to do? Or there may be cases when the station finds that the channel is idle. So at that instant of time, what does the station has to do? In that cases, these things are been divided into 3 types of a persistent method. That is, the persistent methods will be your one persistent, non-persistence and the peak persistence. As far as the one persistent is concerned, what it does, it just finds, okay, you'll be able to see over here, it is of 3 types. One persistent, non-persistence and the peak persistent. Student, the same diagram that is there, okay, it senses the medium. In case suppose it finds it idle, okay, then only it transmits the data as it waits. Suppose it finds that the channel is busy, okay, if in that cases it has to wait, that the station has to wait. The same thing, whatever the 3 diagrams are there, I'll actually explain you all in the form of a flow diagram. Now, as far as the one persistent is concerned, what exactly happens over here? The station checks whether the channel is busy. If the channel is not busy, then the station can transmit. If the channel is busy, okay, then it has to wait. Then again, check whether the station or the channel is busy or not. In the second one, over here, can you all see the non-persistent over here? What exactly happens over here in the non-persistent? The station senses. If it finds that the channel is busy, it waits. Again senses after some time. If it finds that the channel is busy, now can you see till here that the channel was busy? It waits for double the time it was waiting over here. Can you see the wait time over here is lesser compared to the wait time over here? Okay, so which means that the station increases its wait time prior before the prior ones, okay, and then again senses. In case suppose it finds that the station is idle, it sends the data. The same thing is there as far as this flowchart is concerned, students. If you go to see over here, the channel is being sensed by this station. If the channel is idle, it sends the data. If it is not, then it waits random. Now, in these cases, if you go to see, students, what is going to happen as far as your non-persistent is concerned, then you may say that even the other stations may wait, okay, and they may tend to send the data. But if you go to see, it's written over here as randomly. So, the random time of station A, that is waiting, okay, to sense the channel, and the random time of station B to sense the channels will be different. So, because of that, okay, over here, if you use the persistence method, there will be chances that the collision is being lesser compared to that of the random access methods. Okay, so we'll go with the next one, that is the peak persistence. Can you see over here, students? It checks the medium. If it is busy, it waits. Now, R is the random time, P is the probability. It waits for a time slot. Otherwise, okay, if it is fine, again, it backoffs. Okay, again waits. Wait for a time slot. And in case, suppose, if the random time is less than the probability, it sends the data. The same thing is over here, students. It send the station checks whether the channel is busy. If it is not, okay, if it is false, generates a random number, okay, that is 0 to 1, fine. Again checks, okay, if it is false, then it has to wait for the slots. Again, find out that the channel is busy. If it is not, then it creates the random number, okay, from 1 to 0 to 1. In case suppose after coming over, after sensing, that is R value is less than the probability time. R is nothing but a random number. Less than the probability, it is going to send. Okay. Else, it has to wait. Backup process is again, uses backup process as to the collision has occurred. So, it assumes that the collision has occurred and it retransmits the same message. Now, whatever we have studied in the prior, that is over here, that is in the carrier sense multiple access, okay, method does not specify the procedure following the collisions. So, because of that, we are using something called as the carrier sense multiple access with collision detection arguments, okay, algorithm to handle the collisions. In this method, the stations monitors the medium after it sends a frame to see if the transmissions was successful. If so, the station has finished. If, however, there is a collision, the frame is sent again. So, in that cases, over here, what exactly is done as far as your CSMS theory is concerned, the station monitors the medium after it sends the frame, okay, to see if the transmissions was successful. Now, what exactly is done over here is, for example, if there are four stations and station A has sent the data. So, in that cases, there may be a cases where you are using a wired medium. Now, as far as the wire medium is concerned, you all know the length of the wire, okay, it is going to send the same data, I mean, the data in the same form, no matter how many stations are connected to it. So, in such cases, what exactly is happening is, how will station A comes to know whether there is a collision? Station A is going to send the data. If there is nothing, no high frequency has been received, okay, that means that the station, the receiver station, has received the data properly. In case suppose you are using a medium, a wire medium, and station A has sent the data which has led to the collision, there will be some change in the energy of the signals that is there inside the wire. So, because of that, station A will come to know that there is a collision has taken place. Clear? So, I explained the same thing over here, what has actually happened. There are four stations, that is station A, B, C and D. At time T, the first bit of A has been sent. Okay. At the same instance, B, C, before it reaches to C, it sends the medium and it tends to sense the data. That is, A wants to sense the data to D. Say, assume that wants to send the data to A. A senses the medium and checks that the medium is idle. So it tends to sense the data. Before that data reaches to C, C senses the medium and finds that the medium is idle. So it tends to sense the data. But in that cases, what has happened? Can you see that the collision has taken place? So there will be some change in the bit. Okay. So at time T3, okay, C will come to know that the bits has been changed. Fine. So it is going to say, assume that the collision has taken place and it is going to abort it. At time T4, A is going to come to know that the collision has taken place because the first bit of C will be received by A. So because of that, A will come to know that the collision has been taken place and it is going to abort the transmission. The diagrams, this diagrams also is the same thing what we have studied over here. It's the same repetitions. There are four stations that are there. Okay, at time T1, that is A session, A sends the data. After some time, at time that C sends the data. But in the middle, there will be a collision that takes place. C is going to come to know at time T3 because it is going to detect a change in the bit. Okay. A will come to know that at time T4 that the collision has taken place because it is going to receive the first bit of your C. Can you see in this diagram? A first bit of C is be received by the station A. Similarly, first bit of A will be received by the station C. Okay, now we'll take these examples. A network consisting of CSMA CD has a bandwidth of 10 Mbps if the maximum propagation time, including the delays in the devices and ignoring the time needed to send and jamming a signal, okay, is 25.6 microseconds. What is the maximum minimum size of the frame? So the minimum size frame transmission time is TF. It's nothing but 2 into TP. That is nothing but our TP is how much, students? Okay, so our TP will be your 2 into your transmission. Okay, so in that case is 25.6 microseconds you are going to calculate. So, you will be getting the answer. This means that in the worst case, the stations need to transmit for a period of 512.2 microseconds to detect the collision. The minimum size of the frame is 10 Mbps, that is given to us, into 512.2 microseconds, that is nothing but 512 bits or 64 bytes. One byte is equals to 8 bits. So because of that, if I multiply, that is 64 into 8, okay students, I'll be getting the answer as 512 bits. This is actually the minimum size of the frame for a standard Ethernet, okay, which are going to study later in the coming modules. Now the flow diagram of your CSMA CD is nothing but attempts. We are sending it for the first time. So my value of K will be equals to 0. Apply any one of the persistent method. We have studied 3 persistent methods. So apply either one of them in case collision or done. Suppose you have actually sent done with the sending of the data. If there is a collision, okay, transmit and receive. As true, if it is done, collision is detected, you are going to check whether collision has been taken. If not, yeah, it will be a success. In that cases, as far as the CSMA CD is concerned, students, here you are going to send a jamming signal. Jamming signals directly indicates, directly tells all the stations that the collision has taken place or not. If it is taken place, you are going to send the jamming signals. Okay, if it has not been successfully been received by the destination, you are going to increase the value of K. If the K value has reached its maximum value, you are going to abort it. Else, in case suppose the K value has not reached its maximum number or value, you are going to create a random number, wait for TB, that is nothing but a back off time, okay, and again retransmit the same message again. Now the energy level of the transmissions are actually of 3 type: transmission, idleness or collision. Idleness is also called as a zero. Okay, transmission is the time when you are going to transmit the data. Idle is the time when there is no data is sent and the channel is idle. Okay, collision is at the time when there will be a collision that is going to take place between the two or more stations. Now, the next thing that we are going to study is carrier sense multiple access collision avoidance. Now, carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance was invented for wireless networks. Collisions are avoided through the use of CSMA/CA using the three strategies. That is interframe space, the contention window and acknowledgements. Okay, I'll explain you all as far as this figure is concerned. Now, as far as the contention video is concerned, contention video is the time when you are going to send the data. You are going to divide the frames, okay, in the form of a slots and all, and that is the time you are going to send the data. Fine. Then, acknowledgement is nothing but is the time when the receiver receives the message and it is going to tell at the sender end saying that I have received the message properly. So it is going to send the acknowledgement. I have given you examples of your birthday wishes. The moment if someone wishes you in a message form saying that happy birthday. Okay, the moment you read the message, you are going to send a thank you. That is nothing but an acknowledgement saying that you have received the message. You are accepting the wishes sent by the sender. Clear? And the interframe space. Now what is the interframe space is? When an idle channel is found, station does not send data immediately. It waits for some time. So what is going to do? For example, I'll explain you all in these diagrams. Fine. The station wants to send the data. It continuously sends the data. It finds that the station the channel is busy. So it waits. The moment it finds that the channel is idle, immediately it is not going to send the data. It is going to wait for some time. So that time is called as the IFS. IFS is nothing but the interframe sense. Okay. And then later after some time, the station is going to send the data. So that is called as the contention video. The same thing is there in algorithm students. If you go to see initial the value of K will be equals to 0. It is going to find whether the channel is free. If it is true, it is going to wait for some time. That is wait IFS. That is interframe space. It is going to wait for some time. Choose a random number between 0 to 2K minus 1. Okay, send RTS. What is RTS? Is request to send the data. Here you are making a request whether I can send the data or not. You are going to wait for some time. After waiting, you are going to suppose there is a sender and a receiver. So what does the sender does? The sender is going to send the RTS, that is request to send. In that cases, in the form of an acknowledgement, the receiver, the one who is supposed to receive the message, will send CTS. CTS is nothing but clear to send. Fine. That means that it is telling the sender, the receiver is telling the sender that I am ready and you can send me the message. So again the sender is going to wait for some time. And in that cases, after some time only it is going to send the data. Again set a timer. If it receives the acknowledgement, which means that the receiver has received the message properly. If not, you are going to increment the value of K again. Check whether it has received to a maximum limit. If yes, then you are going to abort it. If no, you are going to wait for the TB. That is your TB we have already seen. Back of time. Again, set the medium. Again, wait for some time. If the medium is idle, create a random number. Send an RTS again. Set a timer. Okay, the moment you receive a CTS, wait again for the IFS time. Okay, that is some few seconds of time. If it is nothing is done, then we are going to send the data. Again, send, set the timer, wait for the acknowledgement. And in case suppose you have received the acknowledgement, which means that the receiver has received the message successfully. Now the next part of CSMA and CA and NAV, that is navigation network, it is students. Over here, you can be able to see that is a source, that is a destination and all the other stations. Now, for example, if station A wants to send the data. Fine. Now, over here, once the station wants to send the data, there is something curious. Can you see this DIFS? That is nothing but distributed interframe space. Okay, so it controls the access of the physical medium. So over here, DIFS is nothing but a distributed interframe space. A stations wait for some time, senses the medium. If it finds that the medium is idle, it sends a RTS, that is ready to send. After some time, that is SIFS, that is nothing but a short interframe space, station B sends the CTS, that is clear to send. So what does it mean? It is going to send it to everyone. Station B is going to send the CTS to everyone, saying that it is ready to receive the message. The moment station A, now it was sent by station A, right? Other people have not sent RTS. That is station C and D has not sent RTS. So it is going to ignore the CTS. Okay, assuming that someone else wants to send the data. So what the moment station A received the CTS, it is going to wait for some time. That is short interframe space. It is going to wait for some time. And then later it is going to send the data. So that period, no students, can you see this time is called as the NAV, which means that other stations cannot send the data at that instant of time. They are supposed to wait until and unless A is done by sending of the data. Once that is done, B is going to wait for some time. That is short interframe space. And then B is going to send the acknowledgement. The moment it receives, A receives the acknowledgement and the other receives the acknowledgement, what does it indicate for A? That the message has been received by the destinations properly. What for others it has been sent, the acknowledgement is sent, is only because now it is telling the other stations which are connected that the data transmission is done. And suppose if you all want to send the data, you all can send the data. Okay. The next thing that we are going to send is the control access. What does the control access mean? In control access, the stations consult one another to find which station has the right to send. A station cannot send unless it has been authorized by other stations. Okay, there are altogether three methods over here as far as the control access is concerned. First, we'll go with the reservation. Now, in the reservation, the term itself tells you are supposed to reserve it. You must have reserved your seats, okay, as far as your ticket or railway stations or your railway tickets are concerned or airlines, you are reserving the seats, which means that the same thing, you want that particular seat, okay. The same thing is applicable over here. In the reservation method, the station needs to make a reservation before sending data. Time is divided into intervals. In each interval, the reservation frame precedes the data frame sent in that particular interval. So in that cases, the station has to reserve that particular slot, telling the other station that they are going to send the data at that instant of time. I'll explain you all this in the form of a diagram. Now, can you all see here 5 stations are there? How I'll come to know there are 5 stations? Can you all see the 5 slots over here? That is the reservation frame. Now, in this slot, can you all see 1? Is written 1 over here, which means that station data station 1 is only sending, the other stations are not sending the data at that instant of time. Can you see the data over here? That is the frames here. 1 is written as 1, 3 is written as 1, 4 is written as 1, which means that in this particular slot, station A has sent the data, station 3 has sent the data, and station 4 has sent the data. In that particular slot, station 2 and station 5 has not sent their data. Next one will be the polling. Polling is nothing but over here, polling works with the topologies in which one device is designated as a primary station and the others will be the secondary station. So there will be something called as the successor and the predecessor over here. Okay, all the data exchanges must be made through a primary device even when the ultimate destination is a secondary device. The primary device controls the link, the secondary device follows its instructions. It is up to the primary device to determine which device is allowed to use the channel at that given time. So I'll explain you all this as far as the example is concerned. Okay, the same thing in the form of a diagram. So there is a primary, there are two stations, station A and B. Okay, SCL is nothing but the select. So what happens over here? Suppose if station A wants to send the data, it is going to say to station B. Assume that it is going to send SEL, that is select. Station B is going to send an acknowledgement saying that I am ready now. You can send the data. So what is the primary it is going to do? It is going to send the data. The moment station B received it successfully, it is going to send an acknowledgement saying that I have received the data properly. Okay, as far as the pull is concerned, now what example, for example, here the primary has sent the data to the other stations, that is the secondary station. The secondary stations over here are A and B. Now what in cases where the secondary wants to send the data to the primary? So what does the primary does? It sends a pull to A, asking whether A wants to send the data to the primary. NAC is nothing but I don't want to send. A negative acknowledgement you all can say. Okay, so in case suppose A doesn't want to send your data to the primary, it is going to send a NAC. So what does the primary does? It sends a pull to the B, asking B whether B wants to send the data to primary. If B is ready, it is going to send the data directly. Once the primary receives the data properly, it is going to send an acknowledgement saying that it has received the data properly. Token passing. As far as the topologies are concerned, we have already seen this token passing over there. In a token passing method, the station in a network are organized in a logical ring. In other words, each station, for each station, there is a predecessor and a successor. The predecessor is a station which is logically before the station in a ring. Successor is a station that is after the station in the ring. I'll explain the same thing as far as this diagram is concerned. Over here, altogether there are four types: physical ring, dual ring, bus ring, and the star ring. Clear? Now, as far as the physical ring, that is the first one, is concerned, what exactly is going to happen over here? All the four stations are connected in the form of a ring. Now, in that cases, it's a unidirectional. Can you all see, students, over here? Now, in that cases, a token will be passed between the ring. Token is nothing but it is not going to contain the address of the next, that is the predecessor. For example, if A1 is having the token, okay, it is not going to have the address of the next, because you know it's a unidirectional. So the token is directly going to pass in this order only. Okay, now the token is going to get passed in the network like this, from 1 to 2 to 4 to 3, then again back to 1. Okay. If one wants to send the data, it is going to hold that token. Holding the token is nothing but indicates to the other station that one or someone wants to send the data. Okay, the moment, for example, one wants to send the data to 4. One is going to hold the token to themselves until unless one is done by sending of the data to 4. Once it is done by sending all the data, it is going to release the token. Okay, so that the other stations that is there in the network can send the data. The same thing is going to happen as far as the dual ring is concerned. The dual ring, if you go to see, is, can you all see over here? From station 1, 2, 4, 3, again back to 1. Dual ring, in case suppose the primary one connection, that is the primary ring, fails. Okay, you are going to have a temporary connection. So because of that, it is going to call as a dual ring, which will be in the opposite form. Okay, it works also in the same way how its physical ring works. Clear? So in that cases, this dual ring is actually been used by FDDI, okay, as well as the CDDI. FDDI is nothing but fiber distributed data interface. CDDI is copper distributed data interface. So over here, if station 2 wants to send the data to station 3, it is going to hold the token. Okay, then until unless it is done by sending the data to 3, it is not going to release the token. Once it is done sending of the data, it is going to release the token for the other station to send the data. Now, as far as this one is concerned, initially it will be like a physical ring only, but in case suppose if the primary ring fails or the primary network fails, then only the red one, can you see over here, a temporary connection is going to get set up. As far as the next one, that is the bus ring, is concerned, we have already studied this in the bus topology. A broad medium will be there, a link will be there to all the other stations will be there. So in that cases, what is going to happen over here? The token will be passed, okay? But over here, for example, if token is being held by station 1 and station 1 wants to send the data to 3, the token will contain the address of station 3. Whereas as far as physical ring and dual ring is concerned, the token does not contain the address, okay? But as far as the bus ring is concerned, yes, it contains the address of the next station who wants to send the data. That is, for example, 1 wants to send the data to 3. It is going to contain the address. That is, token is going to contain the address of your 3. Now, bus ring is actually used by token LAN. Similarly, as far as the star ring is concerned, a hub is there to which all the other net stations are connected. Over here also, this topology is being used by token LAN only. So over here, stations, all the stations are connected to the hub. If one wants to send the data to 4, it is going to send it to the hub first, and from the hub, it is going to go to the station 4. We have already studied this as far as the star topology is concerned in the first module. So we'll go with the last part, that is the channelization. Channelizations or channel partitions, as it's sometimes called, is a multiple access method in which the available bandwidth of a link is shared in time, frequency, or through code among the different stations. So we are going to study something called as the frequency division multiple access, time division multiple access, and the code division multiple access. As far as the frequency division multiple access is concerned, the available bandwidth is divided into frequency bands. Each station is allocated a band to send its data. So each station, no matter how many stations are connected, each station will be having a different frequency band. Okay, so there won't be any collisions because each station will be having their own frequency. In other words, each band is reserved for a specific station and it belongs to a station all the time. Each station also uses a band pass filter to confirm the transmitter frequency. I'll explain all this in this diagrams. Now, as far as station 1 is concerned, can you all see? It's blue. The frequency is different. Station 2, frequency is different. Station 3, the frequency is different. Station 4, the frequency is different. Can you all see a gap over here between both? That is station 1 and the station 2. Similarly, station 3 as well as 4. Can you all see a small gap? That is called as the guard bands. It's only because to avoid the overlapping of the frequencies of the different stations, we require the guard bands. TDMA, that is the time division multiple access, instead of actually dividing the stations as per as the frequency wise, we are doing as per the time wise. That is, the station share the bandwidth of the channel in time. Each station is allocated a time slot during its and it can send the data. Each station transmits its data in its assigned time slot. Okay, I'll explain all this in the diagrams. So over here, can you all see? This particular slot is for station 1. This particular time slot is for station 2. This particular time slot is for station 3. And this particular time slot is for station 4. So this is the way how they are going to send the data. Can you all see the gap between the station 1 and station 2? Similarly, station 3, a small gap. That gap is called as the guard times. Okay, this is just to avoid the collisions of the data that has been sent. The last part is the code division multiple access, also called as the CDME, was conceived several decades ago. Recent advances in electronic technology have finally made its implementations possible. CDMA differs from FDMA in that only one channel occupies the entire bandwidth of a link. It differs from TDMA in that all stations can send the data simultaneously. There is no time sharing over here. I explained all the same thing in the form of a diagram. Now over here, students, we are having station 1, 2, 3 as well as your station 4. In station 1, data is consists of D1. Data in station 2 is represented as D2. Data in station 4 is represented as D4 and data in station 3 is represented as D3. For each of the stations, no students, there is something called as the code. Can you all see a C1, C2, C3 and C4? So the data will be what? D1 into C1 plus D2 into C2, D3 into C3 of station 3 and D4 into C4 of station 4. So this is how we are going to send the data. Now, as far as the chip sequence is concerned, this is the code for your station 1, station 2, station 3 as well as your station 4. Clear? So all the code has to be a different one. It cannot be the same one. Data, okay, that is the code of station 1 will be different from that of station 2. Station 2 as well as station 3 as well as station, neither of their code should match. It should not be the same one. Clear? Now, in case suppose you want to represent the data, suppose you want to send the data 0, you are supposed to represent it as minus 1. Suppose you want to send the data as 1, you are supposed to represent it as 1 only. Clear? In case suppose there is nothing idle, then it will be 0. Now, sharing the channel in CDMA. Can you see over here, the bit is 0. Since the bit is 0, how you are going to represent it? Minus 1. So, can you see over here as minus 1? Again, the bit is represented as minus 1. Clear? Because the bit is 0. Represented as 1. Sorry, minus 1. Clear? This station 3 is silent. See, silent means nothing. 0. Okay. Station 4 is bit 1. Okay. Bit 1 means what? Data is represented as 1 only. Clear? So, D1 into C1. Our C1 is what? 1, 1, 1, 1. So, minus 1 into plus 1, minus 1. 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 Similarly, minus 1 into plus 1, minus 1. Minus 1 into minus 1 will be plus 1. This is the code for your station 2. Plus 1 into minus 1, minus 1. Minus 1 into minus 1, plus 1. Similarly, for your station 4. The code is how much? Plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. So, 1 into 1, 1. 1 into minus 1, minus 1. 1 into minus 1, minus 1. 1 into 1, 1. Similarly, for your station 3. The code is how much? Plus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1. It is represented 0. 0 multiplied by anything has to be 0. Now, as far as this formula is concerned, what we have seen? D1 into C1 plus D2 into C2 plus D3 into C3 plus D4 into C4. The same thing we are going to do over here. That is D1 into C1 plus D2 into C2 plus D3 into C3 plus D4 into C4. So what we are supposed to do? Minus 1, minus 1 will be minus 2. Plus 0 will be minus 2. Plus 1 will be minus 1. Clear? Minus 1 plus minus plus 1 will be 0. Plus 0 will be 0. Plus minus 1 will be minus 1. Minus 1 plus minus 1 will be minus 2. Plus 0 will be 0. Plus minus 1 will be minus 3. Similarly, minus 1 plus 1 will be 0. Plus 0 will be 0. Plus 1 will be 1. I hope so you have understood this. Students, if any queries are there, please let me know. Okay, so this is the station 1. Our station 1 bits we know. Minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. Okay, so minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So minus 1 it is represented this way. Station 2. 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1. 1. Sorry, here. Minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Minus 1, represented this way. Plus 1, represented this way. Minus 1, represented this way. Plus 1, represented this way. Session 3. Session 3 is what? 0, 0, 0, 0. So, 0, 0, 0, 0. Nothing. Session 4 is what? Plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Okay, so in that case it is represented as plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Okay, the channel will be how? Now, we have already got the answer. Minus 1, minus 1, minus 3, plus 1. So, minus 1, minus 1, minus 3 students. So, because of that, the signal is bigger. And plus 1. So, because of that, it is plus 1. Clear? Now, decoding the composite signals for 1 in CDMA. Now, for example, now we have already got the data on the channel. So, this will be our data on the channel. Now, in case suppose station 2 wants to sense the data. Now, what is the code of station 2 is this one. That is minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Minus 1, plus 1, minus, plus 1, minus 1. Can you see over here? That is your station 2. Sorry, the code. Plus 1. Minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Okay, the same thing is there over here, students. Fine. Next. This will be the inner product result. And what will be the sum of this? This will be the summing of the results of entire thing. So, this will be answer. Minus 4. How we are getting as minus 4 over here? Is nothing but minus 1, minus 1, minus 3. How much it comes to? Minus 1 plus minus 1, minus 2. Minus 2 plus minus 3, minus 5. Minus 5 plus 1 will be minus 4. Minus 4 divided by the numbers of stations. How many stations we have? 4 stations. 1, 2, 3, 4. So, because of that, 4. We will be getting the answer as minus 1. So, what does minus 1 represent? Nothing but your bit 0. Minus 1 represents the bit 0. I hope so you all have understood this. Next, we'll go with the general rules and the examples of creating wash tables. As far as the wash tables is concerned, students, in case suppose I am having the value as W1. Okay, W1 is given as plus 1. Either I can take the value over here as plus 1 or minus 1. What does 2n indicates over here? In nothing but, suppose if I take this one. Okay, so Wn, Wn, Wn and the complement of Wn will be over here. I'll take the examples. For example, W2, I'm having the value as 1, 1, 1. And the complement of plus 1 will be minus 1. Similarly, W4, suppose if I'm having the value as plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1. It will be the same thing. Plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1. Plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1. What is the complement of this is? Minus 1, minus 1, minus 1 and the plus 1. Okay. The example that I am going to take is find the chips of a network with 2 stations and 4 stations. In case suppose I am having 2 stations, it will be 1, 1. That is plus 1, plus 1. What is the complement of this one will be? Nothing but minus 1. Okay. If I am having the 4 stations. Now 4 stations I have already seen. Now in that cases for 4 stations students what is going to happen? See as far as when I am having 2 stations W2 over here can you all see? Plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1. Plus 1, plus 1. We are supposed to take in the form of a row. Plus 1, plus 1. So because of that plus 1, plus 1. What is the next one says? Plus 1, minus 1. So, plus 1, minus 1. When I am having W4, there are 4 stations. So, in that case is plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. So, this will be plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. What is the next one says? Plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1. Can you see? Plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1. Next one. Plus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1. Plus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So, you are supposed to take in the form of a rows. Clear? Plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Can you all see? Plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Clear? The last examples will be, what is the numbers of sequence if we have 90 stations in our network? In that case, the numbers of the sequence we need is 2 raised to m. If I take the value of m as 7, so n will be 2 raised to 7, which is equals to 128. Now, 128 stations, okay, for 128 stations, I am supposed to take m value as 7. Suppose, students, if I take m value as 6, no? I'll be getting, if I do 2 raised to 6, I'll be getting the answer as 64, which is less than 90. So because of that, I cannot take into consideration all 90 stations. So because of that, I have taken the value of m equals to 7. If I do n equals to 2 raised to 7, I'll be getting 120, which is more than 90, which is not at all a problem. Okay, but it cannot be less than 90. So if I take the value of m as 6, okay, if I do 2 raised to 6, I'll be getting the answer as 64, which is less. So because of that, I cannot take. So we can choose 90 of the sequence as the chips. Okay, with this, we are done with this chapter. Thank you. Start learning. Okay, in case of any difficulties, please let me know. Okay, we'll actually find if any queries are there, we'll rectify it. Thank you.